and welcome to Hot Issues. This week, we are taking a look at a very interesting issue that many people thought was dead. The indications are that it is not over at all. We are talking about the allegations of bribe-taking, or what others have referred to as alleged judicial corruption and its consequences. The case, part of the case went to the Supreme Court and so on. We want to find out really where we are and where we are going with that case. Welcome to Hot Issues. Hello and welcome to Hot Issues. And as I indicated, we are looking at alleged judicial corruption, or what some have referred to as alleged judicial bribe taking. Part of the case went to the Supreme Court, and there are all kinds of speculations about where we are and where we are likely to go. And we are privileged to have with us in the studio for this conversation, Ni Kpakpo Addo, counsel for Justice Paul Dery. So you're welcome to the studio.
Uncle Kwesi, most grateful, extremely grateful, privileged.
You were in the Supreme Court.
Yes.
What did you take to the Supreme Court?
Well, Uncle Kwesi, the antecedent of this case was very, very simple. Mr. Justice Paul Dery was a justice of the Superior Court. Now, he received a phone call from the office of the Chief Justice indicating that there was a petition against him and that he was supposed to pick up the copy of the petition and respond to it in accordance with Article 146, for the Chief Justice to then, based on his response, make a determination as to whether a prima facie case has been made against him per the petition, and then whether she would then, if the prima facie case has been made against him, forward him to a committee to be set up to investigate the said petitions, if the Chief Justice made a prima facie finding against him. So Mr. Justice Dery was putting together his response when all of a sudden the petitioner, which is Tiger IPI, put out a release, an advert all over that it was going to show the contents of the petition and the audiovisuals in support of the said petitions at the conference center. Immediately, Justice Dery drew the attention of the petitioner through a lawsuit that it is unconstitutional for anyone who has filed a petition against a justice of the Superior Court, pursuant to Article 146, to purport to disclose the contents of the petition or documents or evidence that the person will rely on in support of the petition when the impeachment process has not been completed. It went all the way in the High Court, even to the day that the said audiovisuals were supposed to be displayed. I mean, we all know what happened. So the contentious issue at that point, because at that time, Justice Dery, up until today, has not responded to the said petition. So the contentious issue was whether the showing was a constitutional act or whether it was done in violation of the Constitution and what was the legal consequence if indeed the action of the petitioner was in violation of the Constitution. One other significant concern that Justice Dery had was that the identity, you know, the Chief Justice is supposed to conduct a prima facie finding. And one of the key things that the prima facie finding is, because it's a finding of fact, as to the identity of the petition, of the named judges in there. So if the names are released before the that exercise is done, it virtually is a violation of the confidentiality principle guarding the proceedings in respect of Article 146. So he put that together in a writ, seeking four substantial reliefs and some consequential that will flow if the four reliefs were granted. The first one was that the petitioner, Tiger IPI, whether that entity had violated Article 146 by releasing the contents of the petition as displayed at the conference center. The second was against the chief executive officer, because the entity Tiger I had put out that its chief executive officer was Mr. Anas Arimia Anas. Therefore, Mr. Anas Arimia Anas also acts as the editor-in-chief or acting editor-in-chief of the New Crusading Guide. The newspaper serialized the contents of the petition, and he also put out the contents on his Facebook page and other social media. So the second major relief that was sought was whether that act by Mr. Anas Arim Yawanas as an individual was also inconsistent and in contravention of the 1992 Constitution. The third relief had to do with the Chief Justice of the Republic of Ghana acting through the Judicial Secretary as to whether the release of the names of the judges prior to the determination of the prima facie case against them also was in violation of Article 146 of the Constitution. And then fourthly, based on the fact that we had come under Article 2.1 of the 1992 Constitution, which states in general or in summary that where you allege that any person has done an act which is inconsistent or in contravention of the 1992 Constitution, you had a duty to bring it to the Supreme Court for declarations to be made to that. And that if the Supreme Court makes those declarations in Article 2.1, then flowing in Article 2.2, the court is empowered to make orders to give effect and meaning to the declarations that had been made in Article 2.1. So we came then under Article 2.2 to say that if indeed the court agrees that the actions of these persons have been in violation of Article 146, then the court should nullify the petition because there will be no legal foundation upon which the petition should be allowed to stand. Three out of these four reliefs were granted by the Supreme Court unanimously, 5-0, in confirmation of the case of Ajechu versus the Attorney General, that in principle, once you hand over a petition to the president under Article 146, you are not allowed to disclose anything in the petition. The only thing you are allowed to say is that I have sent a petition. So any unlawful disclosure of the contents of the petition constitutes a violation of Article 146 of the 1992 Constitution. The court, however, said that it will refuse our fourth request, which was to nullify the said petition on just account of the mere disclosure, because the court was of the opinion that as a public policy consideration, what it could potentially do is that it could open the door for any judge against whom an allegation had been made to in concert with other interested parties, unlawfully release the contents of the information and use that as an escape route. We felt that, well, as much as we would have wanted the court to affirm previous positions, because this Supreme Court has affirmed in numerous cases that once an act is in violation of the Constitution, it will go ahead and nullify it, no matter the consequences that flow from there. But they drew our attention, of course, to the recent election petition, that even in the absence of the signatures of the presiding officers, the law, the court still held that the election results were indeed valid. So they made a clear distinction, said that, however, it doesn't mean that the persons who had committed these acts did not deserve or could not be punished in other ways, and that there were other remedies available to us if we felt, and indeed, since the finding of fact was that the privacy of Justice Paul Dery and the others had been violated, and that there were other remedies, which include contempt proceedings, we could file for defamation, among other relief. So it's not as if it is a closed, it's that we don't have any other relief. But on this occasion, they will refuse to endorse our request for a nullification. So it is weird that for a person that goes to a court for four substantive reliefs and is able to get three out of those four reliefs, and that the case in the court, in fact, sometimes we have to be clear on that, his case in the court was about the constitutionality of releasing the contents of a petition or the evidence in support of the petition whilst the impeachment process was ongoing. We did not deal with the petition head on. So it is fair, in my opinion, and in the opinion of my client, that the court asked him to deal with the petition on its own. So we received instructions from Mr. Justice Dery and two other justices that I represent, who have also been named in the said allegations, that is Mr. Justice Mustafa Logo and Justice A.C. Addo, to proceed to the Supreme Court and deal with a very important issue. Now, Justice Dery, having not answered to the petition, has instructed the lawyers to now deal with the contents of the petition. Now, the lawyers have hit a roadblock in that the entity, and it is very, very important that...
Before we get there, I've seen screaming newspaper headlines,
yes,
you know, proclaiming that the case of Justice Dery has been thrown out by the Supreme Court.
It's that's what is amazing, Because Justice Dery went to the Supreme Court on specific. You don't just go to the Supreme Court for the fun of it. You go there on major constitutional issues. And so what he went there for, because remember that there was a huge debate in this country as to whether the viewing or the showing of the said audiovisuals at the conference center was a lawful act. Mm-hmm. Indeed, we went even up to the day of the said viewing, where I was in court on my feet seeking for an injunction against the showing of the said video. I had to withdraw the said motion because we had also filed another one on the conference center managers. But what was in issue was that even at the High Court, the court had expressed a certain opinion, even though not clear, not on the record, that perhaps for public interest, it may be that the public have a right to see and view the said video. So at least we are all clear in our minds that it is an unlawful act for you to submit a petition under Article 146 and proceed to show the said video to the general public or leak it to the media or anybody else other than the persons who have been authorized to see the contents of the said video. The court says if you are successful and the process is over, nothing precludes the president from releasing the contents of the report of the committee, because indeed the people have the right to know mm-hmm. what the contents of the report is. But when the process is ongoing, on account of the fact that the judiciary is a very sensitive institution, the judge will not have the opportunity in the in-camera proceedings to respond to you, who have the opportunity to go out of the in-camera proceedings and make the allegations out there, because you may end up not being successful in your said petition. We felt that based on the general principle that an unconstitutional act is an illegal act, the court should have granted our request. But of course, you have to be a good Democrat. If you go to the Supreme Court, you know that the court can either agree with you or disagree with you. But where three of the four reliefs have been granted, how can that writ have been described as incompetent or a complete waste of time, or that we had been thrown out? If we were thrown out, then none of the reliefs should have been granted. So either it was a miscommunication or it was a deliberate act of mischief by some persons to put out the part of the information that suited for them and to leave out the part which was actually the heart of the case in court and which has settled for all intents and purposes any doubt that what the petitioner did at the conference center was an unlawful act.
Now you've got three reliefs out of four.
Yes.
What does it do to the substantive matter of the allegations against Justice Dery and the other judges?
Yes. You see, there's also been a misconception that the procedural matters in Article 146 are not as important as the substantive matter. I'll refer anyone who has that opinion to Article 146(3) of the Constitution and also 146(2). This, in sum, indicates that that you cannot remove a justice of the Superior Court unless it is in accordance with the procedure laid down in Article 146. So the procedure that you will seek to remove the judge is of equal importance as the substance of the allegations. And that is why, consistently, it matters not the nature of the allegations that you are making, because you can all make wild allegations. But when you decide to come under the ambit of the constitutional provisions, you must respect the procedure that has been laid down in Article 146. So Mr. Justice Dery, for the information of all those who feel that he is wasting his time and he's the scrutiny that he's attaching to the said procedure that has been adopted by the petitioner, is within his rights under Article. In fact, he has a duty to ensure that if ever he's removed, he was removed in accordance with the procedure set out in Article 146. And that is a right no one can take away from him, because it is conferred by the Constitution. So once you have decided and elected to come under Article 146, you are bound by that provision. There are other ways of dealing with judges, errant judges, and this has been done many, many times. You can bring a petition to the Judicial Council. If the Judicial Council investigates it and believes that there is merit in the allegation, the Judicial Council now becomes the complainant and forwards the complaint to the President for those articles in Article 146 to be activated. But when you decide that you want to bring a petition under Article 146 straight to the president, pursuant to your belief that the person against whom you are making the allegation has erred and is incompetent to hold office, then you are bound by that particular petition and you must respect the procedure. Remember also that the fact-finding committee is not a law court. So they generally do not entertain legal objections. If you have any legal objections, you must deal with them before you go before the committee. Because once you go before the committee, you waive all those legal objections that you have to, you could have raised before going before the committee, and you deal with the substance of the allegations as they are. So we want to exhaust and intend to exhaust every legal angle in respect of the rights that we have been conferred upon us under Article 146. Then we would move into the issue of the committee, because we believe that there are serious defects with the said petition which must be addressed by the court. And now that the court has given us the opportunity, that it has dealt with the issue of whether or not it was constitutional for him to have done what it did, the petitioner to have done what it did at the conference center, we are dealing with the petition head on. And so we have taken instructions from our client and we are proceeding to deal with the petition.
Now, here is the Supreme Court.
Yes.
And it says that Tiger Eye,
yes,
erred in showing the evidence.
That is true.
And then it says also that Anas Arimuyao Anas erred.
Yes.
And then it says that the Chief Justice or her office also violated the Constitution,
yes,
by making certain disclosures.
Yes.
But at the same time, the Supreme Court refuses,
yes,
to strike out petition.
That's true.
Which means that the case is still pending.
That is true. That's exactly what.
What has happened? What is the full implication of what has happened?
What?
Justice Dery still has to go through the process.
He's going now that he has instructed us to deal with the petition, we are taking the petition head on.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the first and interesting thing is that there must be what? A petition that is sent to the president. And within Article 146, it equates the petition to a complaint.
Mm-hmm.
Which means that there must be a complainant, somebody who is making the complaint. Within the jurisprudence of this country, the courts have had the opportunity to determine who a complainant is, and indeed even the capacity to bring the said action has also been determined by the Supreme Court in this particular country.
Mm-hmm.
So the person who is bringing the said petition must be in existence. It means that for a petition, there must be what? A petitioner. And for that complaint, there must be somebody who made the complaint.
But Anas Arimuyao Anas,
yes,
is a human being,
yes,
who is known.
Yes.
He came to court even if hooded.
Yes.
Or somebody,
yes,
presenting as Anas Arimuyao,
yes,
Anas. What is this problem with the identity, true identity and capacity of the individual?
Now, Uncle Kwesi, without going into the merits of the case that we filed in the Supreme Court,
mm-hmm,
when we received instructions yesterday from our clients to respond to the petition, we did due diligence, because one of the things you have to do is to ascertain the identity of the entity that you are seeking to respond to. Because remember that potentially you could be engaging the person in cross-examination and also dealing with issues of credibility. So you must ascertain that the entity, remember that. And people must be clear. The fact is that in the petition, the petitioner is Tiger Eye PI.
Not Anas.
Not Mr. Anas. So Mr. Anas Arimuyao Anas actually has no issues. Mr. Anas Arimuyao Anas is the chief executive officer of the company called Tiger Eye, if indeed that company exists, called Tiger Eye PI. So we are supposed to respond to who? Tiger Eye PI. Because per the rules, there must be a petitioner who files a petition. Now, if the entity that says it is the petitioner is not existing, because now every company you know must be registered with the Registrar General's Department, and once you put yourself out as Tiger Eye, now in one breath, we've heard persons who speak for the entity say it is Tiger Eye PI. In fact, we can only deal with Tiger Eye PI because that is what is in the petition. And remember, the petition is a very serious document. This is not a document that you can just file and claim that you are making mistakes here, you are doing amendments here. This is a document that seeks to remove from office a justice of the Superior Court. So you must know exactly what you are doing before you bring the petition before the committee or before the Chief Justice, because these are not organs of state that you go playing around with. When you say that you are an entity and you project yourself as a company limited by the laws of this country, it means that, number one, you must be registered with the registrar of companies.
Mr. Martin Amidu, former Attorney General, did raise this issue.
Precisely.
And I followed it quite a bit.
Yes.
Are you raising the same issues that Mr. Martin Amidu raised?
To a large extent, we are. And we have done our own searches. The documents available to us as we speak indicate that the entity that filed the petition does not exist. I cannot go beyond that because the matter is in the Supreme Court because we filed it yesterday. And so we cannot go into the merits of our arguments because we are even yet to file our statement of case. But our argument is very simple. Per the decisions of the Supreme Court in previous cases, there must be an identifiable complainant. And in this instance, there must be an identifiable petitioner. So the petition is linked to the petitioner because it is the petitioner that must file a petition. A petition cannot arise out of a vacuum. So when the president received the petition, it is deemed that he had received it from whom? A petitioner. Now, if the identity of the petitioner is in doubt, and if indeed it is proven that the said petitioner does not exist, what it means is that there is no petition to answer to.
But sir, you went to the Supreme Court.
Yes.
Seeking certain reliefs.
Yes.
And one of those reliefs was that the petitioner, or alleged petitioner,
yes,
had violated the Constitution.
Yes.
How can a non-existent entity,
yes,
violate the Constitution?
Now, what is interesting is that at the suit we took to the Supreme Court dealt with the publication of the petition. It had nothing to do with the capacity of the petitioner. Because at that time, that issue was not, we had not responded to the petition. Remember that as we speak, it is not that Justice Dery is going to respond to the petition because the Supreme Court has stated that it is a valid petition. And once it's a valid petition, he has a duty to respond to it. Other than that, the process can go on without you because you've been given an opportunity. So he's given his instructions. My lawyers, respond to the petition. If we have evidence that the petitioner does not exist, immediately we have a duty to bring it to the attention of the person to whom the petition was sent. Because that person will have to be sure that indeed he was dealing with what? An identifiable body. If the petition is flawed, and this is a fundamental flaw, it is not a flaw to do with just dates or time. This goes to the root.
Spelling error.
Spelling error. This goes to the root. Because now it is incumbent upon, provided we are able to provide the evidence, the petitioner will have to prove that the identity that he used in presenting the petition actually is there. And it's very, very fundamental.
Okay, so we're going to have a very short break. And when we come back, I'd like us to explore this apparent confusion between identity and capacity.
Very true.
Identity and capacity. Are they one and the same? What is it? What are the legal implications of all of this and so on? So, viewers, we are in conversation with one of the lawyers of Justice Paul Dery. And we are discussing the recent Supreme Court decision, its implications, and the future of the allegations which have been made against some judges in Ghana. A short break. Hello and welcome back to Hot Issues, and we are in conversation about an issue which is tending to be very controversial and sometimes misunderstood in many ways. And we are talking about the alleged judicial corruption or alleged judicial bribe-taking and the recent Supreme Court decision on the matter with respect to Justice Paul Dery. Now, sir, what are we talking about? Are we talking about the identity of the petitioner or the capacity of the petitioner, or are the two in any way linked?
The two are very conjoined. And as I said, we will not be discussing the merits because we are not providing any evidence or anything. But just as a way of education, the law requires that a petition is presented to the president. Now, even common sense will tell us that it means that someone, whether it's a natural person, so it could have been Kofi Mensah, who is a citizen of Ghana, of course, and then he goes to present a petition because he believes that something, the said judge has engaged in some misconduct, and therefore he needs to be sanctioned. So he brings the petition to the president, and the president will refer it to the chief justice. The chief justice will ask you to respond, and then you potentially, if prima facie findings are made against you, will be coming before a committee to deal with the contents of the petition. Now, there is that fundamental issue. And if you remember the Richard Adani case, for example.
Mm-hmm. The case that went to Shrad.
The way that went to Shrad.
Yeah.
Mr. Adani raised the fundamental point right from the beginning that the said allegation was picked in the media and that there must be a complaint and that that complaint connotes the fact that there must be an identifiable complainant and that in the absence of an identifiable complainant, he cannot, by any stretch of the imagination, be made to respond to a non-existent entity. Who is he responding to? And that it will mean that you can go on a fishing expedition, fish out whatever, and that you could be described as an octopus going around fishing for allegations and coming and around. Every judge will not be able to work because every day frivolous allegations can be filed with the president, and all the president will do is to forward it to the chief justice. The chief justice will just be summoning you each and every day. This is a serious business, so we need to deal with it in a very serious manner. Mm-hmm. And the Supreme Court upheld this. I remember that the findings were made against Mr. Richard Annan. He was made to resign. Then he went to the Supreme Court and fought his case and said that in the absence of an identifiable complainant, you cannot file or deal with him when there is no identifiable complainant. And the court was very clear. The court advanced a lot of reasons why there must be necessarily a complainant. Now, in this particular instance, and in Adjechum and other cases, the courts have been very, very clear that you are dealing and you must necessarily deal with an identifiable person, whether it's a natural or artificial person. You must be in existence. So if the existence of the petitioner is in question, then naturally, how does our client respond to the petition? Because he must respond necessarily to the petition, which connotes that there is what? An identifiable petitioner. So instantly and immediately, we have to draw the attention of the relevant authorities that they are dealing with a non-existent entity. And then until that person is able to prove his identity, how is Justice Dery supposed, in all fairness, to be deal with a non-existent entity which has purported to file a petition? Are we dealing with a true person or are we dealing with somebody else? So it is important for us because remember, as much as, and that is the unfortunate thing, we are dealing with a corporate entity and people must get that straight. We are not dealing with Mr. Anas Arimia Anas because everybody knows Mr. Anas. I know Mr. Anas Arimia Anas. If I see him, I know him. So everybody knows that this is Mr. Anas Arimia Anas. If Mr. Anas Arimia had filed the petition in his capacity as Mr. Anas Arimia Anas, a Ghanaian and a journalist, there would have been no problem. That we would even not be dealing with. We would be dealing with the other issues pertaining to the petition. But once the petition was filed by an entity called Tagger IPI, then in fact it is a duty incumbent on us as his lawyers to ensure that that entity actually exists and that we are not responding to some pseudonym or some other person who does not exist. It's very, very important.
Now, sir, let us say, for the purposes of this conversation,
yes,
that Tagger IPI does not
exist. Tagger IPI.
Tagger IPI,
yes,
does not have a legal existence.
Yes.
Let us say,
yes,
for the purpose of this conversation,
yes,
that is the case. Now, if that were the case,
yes,
would that mean that the allegations by themselves are also not true or non-existent?
The point is this. If there's no petitioner, there can be no petition. Because what will you be responding to? That is the issue. Because you understand me. That petition cannot come out of a vacuum. Then it means that the president was the one that instituted the action against Mr. Justice Dery. Mm. Which is not so. Because the constitution is very clear. The president must receive a petition. Which means that someone, however described, must present the petition. And We have, Mr. Anasarino has stated categorically that he was the one that signed the petition on behalf of who? Tiger IPI. As the what? Chief Executive Officer. So necessarily, he is a servant of the company. And the company must be the one to be dealt with, not Mr. Anas. Because there's no problem with Mr. Anas. He is there. We all know him. He has been coming and dealing with the committee and all like this. However, in all situations, the complaint and the petition was filed in the name of Tiger IPI. So the existence of Tiger IPI is a prerequisite to being to the petition being dealt with. You can't divorce the petition. It's different in the first instance. You could divorce the publication from the petition because they were not one and the same. You could not say the publication was the same as the petition. Now, you cannot say that you want to divorce the petition. I don't know, that it would be an unfair exercise because it would mean that the persons that were selected by the petitioner were selected for reasons other than what they alleged to have done. Mm-hmm. It will be selected and it will be discriminatory mm-hmm. because you cannot say that in the absence of a petitioner, the man is supposed to answer questions and to interrogate who. If the person who filed the petition is A, he must know that he's dealing with A because when it comes to cross-examination, he will be dealing with the credibility of the witness. He will be dealing with the demeanor of the witness. He will be dealing with the motives of the witness. He will be dealing with what is the truth in respect of whether the witness is speaking the truth. So the credibility of the person who has filed the petition is of grave importance to the case of the petitioner. He must be, to the case of the accused person, he must be able to cross-examine that person and he must be able to deal with issues of credibility. So the person who files the petition is as important as what he has filed. In fact, they are one and the same. Absence a petitioner, absence a petition.
Okay. Now you've raised another issue about cross-examination, yes. credibility, demeanor of witnesses and so on.
Yes.
Now this brings into sharp focus one of the issues which has been discussed since this alleged scandal broke,
precisely.
Which is getting hooded witnesses in court.
Yes. We haven't gotten to that bridge yet.
No, but it has come up.
Yes, it has come up. But you see, we don't do our legal work in isolation. I can offer and proffer an opinion, and I'll do so just as an opinion without it being a representation of what my client believes or otherwise.
Exactly.
Yes. So we are dealing with this purely as my personal opinion.
As a lawyer.
As a lawyer.
Is it permissible to have hooded witnesses in court? And what does that do for the case of the defense, which has to test the demeanor of witnesses and so on?
We have always, and it is an important part of assessing the credibility, it's one of the criteria, which is the demeanor of the witness. So far, no one has brought that up in the court in respect of the Supreme Court or the High Court. What has recent decision that dealt with an administrative hearing where there was a request by some persons who had been during one of these investigations by Mr. Anas, Arimi Anas, that they wanted to interrogate him. He said they should use a questionnaire. They said they wanted him there, so they refused to have it. So the point is this. When you have a legal objection, you can't sleep in your house or sit in your bed, cry that you have a legal objection, and not proceed to challenge it. Because that's the problem. If you refuse to exercise your rights, then those rights are waived and are considered waived. So if indeed you feel strongly, and that's why I believe that my senior brother, Egbert Fable, has gone to court on this particular matter. We are yet to get a pronouncement on it, that he was not going to allow his clients to cross-examine a hooded person. We have not had any pronouncement from the courts. You see, when the courts speak like they did yesterday, we have clarity in the issue. Now, as we said, we know that if you file a petition with the president in respect of the removal of a superior court judge, you cannot put the information out there. If you do so, it will be unconstitutional. That is the kind of clarity that the law brings. So, unfortunately, we haven't gotten to that bridge. Perhaps, if we ever get to that bridge, we may have to test that issue. Because the cross-examination and the demeanor of the witness, the motive of the witness, the truthfulness of the witness, and other such indices are as crucial as the evidence that a person is given.
Now, sir, the court has said that the Constitution was violated.
Yes.
And the court has said more or less, I mean, this is the highest court of the land.
So,
that there are other remedies available to you, and those remedies would include contempt.
Yes.
They would include defamation. Are you taking steps in that direction? Will you take steps
in that direction? As a lawyer, we work again according to instructions. Our clients are fighting a lot of battles at different times. So, to borrow the words of Mr. Chachikata, you fight the one that deals with your survival first, and then you look at the other matters second. When he recently did an interview, you know, he's an icon I admire very much. We want to deal with the crucial and fundamental issues first. We have some matters in the High Court. We considerably will have to amend some of it because we've dealt with one major leg of that. And so the High Court matter in respect of that is no more relevant because the Supreme Court has dealt with that. Maybe, just so as for persons not to engage in such reckless conduct ever again, we may test the law, but I don't have express instructions to go in that direction yet. But there's indication that perhaps just so that another person tomorrow does not turn around, because that's the danger, that if you don't see any consequences flowing from the unconstitutional act of these persons, then potentially they are free to do the same thing next time. But as it is now, we have a fundamental question. We have a petition that we have to deal with. You cannot fight so many battles and have open different war fronts at the same time. So we want to tunnel our vision closely to what we have at the table now. Once that one is resolved, then perhaps we'll look at some of the, but the matter is not dead yet. So, and there's no statute of limitations or that. At least the court has given indication that that conduct will not be countenanced, and that we have every right to pursue those who were in violation of that. And I think it's good too, because once it's coming from the Supreme Court, the lower courts will take heed and abide by that particular caveat, that once a finding of fact has been made that there was a breach, we are entitled to some, and in fact, one of it is even damages. So the third one was damage. In fact, they listed five. The third one was damages. And so that is one of the remedies that is available to us in respect of that. We didn't ask for it in the Supreme Court, so they couldn't, of course, award it to us there. And they don't normally deal with personal issues. You have to go to the High Court for personal enforcement of some of these things that you would want to be dealt with.
When you come out, when your vision comes out of the tunnel,
yes,
and you want to go for these remedies, would you be minded by the broad implications of seeking these remedies? For example, I've counted media houses, 5, 10, 15, 20 of them.
Yes.
Who were engaged in these publications.
Yes.
Yeah. Would that not bring about mayhem on the media landscape?
We did. There's a defamation suit pending against especially the sponsors of the conference center showing. Mm. That's being spearheaded by one of my clients, Justice AC Addo. He's filed those, and per the ruling, that the judgment of the Supreme Court is going to have a very interesting impact on the High Court case, because now the Supreme Court is saying that once you did that, potentially you have violated the Constitution. Now, to the extent that you violated the Constitution, what are the damages that we are entitled to? So those are issues that my clients will be looking critically at in the coming days.
Okay. Now, sir, you are back in the Supreme Court.
Yes.
Where does that take this case? What are the issues that the Supreme Court now has to determine, and what will be their impact on the substantive petition?
Now, this particular action that we filed is a very, for us, simple and straightforward issue. We are being asked to respond to a petition. We say that the prerequisite for filing the petition is that there must be a petitioner. In the absence of a petitioner, we are saying there's no petition for us to answer. The court should make that declaration so that my clients are able to go back to their normal duties and continue to do what they have to, until a correct and identifiable petitioner pops his head up.
But if the court were to make this decision, would that not mean that even the judges who have been dismissed will have to come back to work?
Well, unfortunately, that could and potentially will be the result if those reliefs are upheld. And the court, you see, the point is this. The court cannot and will not be a conduit for the endorsement of an illegal act. It is very, very important. In Mr. Richard Anani's case, whatever the findings of charge were, once there was the absence of an identifiable complainant, the matter was made to die. It was died a natural death because, and remember that Mr. Ribodacha was invited many, many times by society and to file a formal petition in respect of a formal complaint. He never did. Mm-hmm. Maybe that would have helped to, you know, evolve the legal discourse in respect of that. Mm-hmm. For us, we are fighting our battles of today. Our battle today is that there is no identifiable complainant. What the legal effect will be when it comes to that is up to the petitioner because he filed his petition. My clients were doing and going about their business when the petition was filed against them. If you withdraw your petition, well, they go back to their duties until they are called upon to answer any petition. I know that people are anxious that the contents of the petition be answered. But remember that the constitutional provision also provides that the procedure that you seek to remove the judge must be in accordance with that particular provision. So if there is no petitioner, there can be no petition. Other than that, it will constitute an unfair exercise. Because
would it not be said that the petitioners, given their technical skills and competences, have used technicalities to get out of a lockjam?
If it is a technicality, in fact, I would be surprised for somebody to talk about technicality, because I explained earlier, the constitutional provision is clear. The procedure, in fact, and it's a categorical statement, that a justice of the Superior Court shall be removed in accordance with the procedure as laid down in Article 146. It is not about the fact that, oh, based on the allegation that the person makes, if it is a serious allegation, then the person should be removed. It's about proof. So if you are bringing the proof, you must be there. We are saying you don't exist because, it is not the accused person that said A is Tiger IPI Limited. It is the person who filed the petition that put a certain clock around and said, I exist. I am Tiger IPI Limited. So if we are able to take away that clause that you have put on and we are able to prove that you don't exist, then who sent the petition? That is an interesting question.
So we're going to take another short break. Very well. And when we come back, I'd like us to look at the impact of this case on the administration of justice in the country. You've made all the points about process and so on. But what about the consequences, you know, whatever the outcome of the Supreme Court decision is, on the administration of justice in Ghana? Hello and welcome back to Hot Issues, and we are dealing with an issue which is really hot. Allegations of judicial corruption, allegations of judicial bribe-taking, and all of that. Now, sir, how does all of this affect the administration of justice in Ghana today?
I think that it is interesting. You know, people have talked about the moral angle. And I think that we have to ask ourselves a fundamental question. Is there evidence that these judges went out of their way, if some of them, to demand bribes from anyone? I think that's a very important question that we seem not to be asking ourselves. Also, are these judges not entitled to make sure that they protest their innocence? Because I get a bit worried when persons are saying that on account of some audiovisuals that they have seen, and having had that one side of the story presented, the other side does not deserve any right to have that process examined, cross-examined, and for them to be able to have their day. It's as if we're saying that as long as it's a particular person speaking, and based on whatever ocular evidence the person provides, that is conclusive evidence of guilt.
What people are saying is that they saw video clips in which a goat or goats,
yes,
allegedly was being presented in a judge's house.
And so that they is evidence.
They saw video clips, yes, in which judges, yes, were receiving monies for persons who claimed that they were offering bribes.
That is the interesting
they
thing.
They saw video clips.
That's the interesting thing. Know, I have not seen, apart from the evidence that was provided in respect of my clients, I haven't watched the videos. Mm-hmm. Because you see, there are even issues about how those audiovisuals were procured. And you cannot build, you cannot seek to say that you want to unlawfully obtain a lawful, you can't build an unlawful act on, you can't build a lawful act on an unlawful act. You can't violate somebody's rights in furtherance of what you claim to be justice. Where is the justice?
Is it unlawful to film somebody who is involved in a potentially, and I'm choosing my words very carefully, potentially criminal act?
Do you instigate a potentially criminal act and say that that act is a criminal act? I think that we should be asking.
You're talking about entrapment here.
Well, you see, the point is, we have filed some matters in court in relation to that. Because you see, there are laws that protect the data of persons in this country. There's a Data Protection Act. There's a right to privacy in this country. So, it is not, you see, there must be a distinction between a situation where you have stumbled upon somebody committing a crime, and then you take graphic images of that perpetration of the crime and you present it as evidence, as opposed to you inducing someone to allegedly commit a crime, and then you go ahead after inducing the person to say that the person has committed a crime. For me, it's amazing, you know, and I think we are living in very, very interesting times. Because potentially, Uncle Kwesi, if I don't like your face and I think you are in a position where I must take you out for me to be able to move on, or for whatever reason, whatever motive, and imagine that we are dealing with the law courts. You are in a case with someone. The person knows he has a bad case and knows that maybe you are potentially going to be victorious in the case, and then decides that he's going to employ somebody to make sure that the judge is taken out of the case so that you will win your case even though you have a bad case. Would that not be a recipe for chaos in this country? No one is saying that if someone does a voluntary act which constitutes a wrong in within our laws, that person should not be dealt with. But don't tell me that you instigate somebody to do something and at the end of the day you seek to benefit from that wrongful act. I don't believe in that. And that is why I think the courts should speak, and speak loudly, so that we are all clear in our minds.
After the court has spoken, are we not coming up against public perception? After the court has spoken.
You see, that is why it was wrong in the first place to put out the issue. Yes, we are dealing with the matter after the fact. You understand? That is why I felt, and I still believe, that the court perhaps should have set a clear signal so that that a conduct will never occur again. Perhaps you will have, the court could also have ruled that you also have other remedies of dealing with the said that. But once you have put out the info, because that is the heart of it, let us go through the due process so that we could have taken these people out and not destroy the institution, the very institution that we all run to. And that is the interesting thing. That Uncle Kwesi, if today you are hounded by anyone, or I am hounded by anyone, it is the judiciary that will go to. Investors come into this country, and one of the cardinal points they look out for is whether you have a judiciary that is corruption-free. Now, if you bastardize that institution, and after that you say you are cleansing the institution, have you not already done enough damage to the institution? What about the clean judges? Would they not be painted with the same brush? That is why the framers of the Constitution ensured that once allegations are made, and remember, no one is saying that those allegations should not be investigated, but because of the potential public relations problems it may pose for the judiciary, you definitely have to have them in camera, even in our traditional setting. Is it all matters that we put out in the public or are adjudicated publicly in the chief's court or even in our own homes? Is it everything that we put out for our children to see or for every neighbor to see? There are some fights you have in the open, but there are some fights you sit down with your wife and you resolve in the bedroom. Why do we think that if you have other relatives in the house and you have a problem with your wife, you shouldn't stand outside there and debate it for the whole world to hear? If if we even believe in our own homes, we have a right to some privacy. How much more those who also are working in the public space? Does it mean that they give everything up when they become judges and that they do not have any rights? Yes, Caesar's wife must live above reproach, must live above suspicion.
What role would you prescribe for journalists generally, and more particularly investigative journalists, in the fight against all forms of corruption, including judicial corruption?
You know, we've all admired the work of Mr. Anas Arena Anas. I personally, he's a friend, and I admire him and admire his work considerably. He's done a lot. But even our state security agencies under the State Intelligence Act are required to go for warrants when they are performing such actions, tapping people. Because, you see, it is a dangerous weapon in the hands of the executive or anybody if it is not censored or if it has no safeguards. Imagine that you cannot make telephone calls without worrying whether someone is listening, that you cannot have discussions. Uncle Kwesi, you're a political figure. Imagine you cannot discuss politics openly and freely, and that whenever you are walking around, you have to look beyond your shoulder. It is a dangerous recipe to have. That is why the fundamental human right, the right to privacy, is considered to be a cardinal principle of any democratic society. So, yes, private investigators have to work. Their work is important, but it must be done in accordance with the rule of law. That is what makes our society a great one. When everyone lives and abides by the basic law of the land, no one is treated differently because of name, race, color, where you come from, who you are. That at the end of the day, when I take a matter to court, I know and I'm guaranteed that the law would be applied impartially. That is the cardinal principle that we all uphold. So that if you want to interrogate me, you either go for a warrant if you're a private investigator, so that it's clear that when you are doing what you are doing, you later on, no one will have the opportunity to challenge it and say that you did it unlawfully.
Now, sir, all of you, very brilliant, eloquent lawyers and so on, were in this country. Anas did, or Tiger IPI did the same things to customs, they did the same thing to people working in the Electricity Company of Ghana and so on. Why were you silent then?
You see, I am a lawyer, I've been engaged by certain persons to represent them. Maybe you could have asked, why have we not spoken as individuals in a society? I think that sometimes one must be careful to draw a distinction between some of the things that Mr. Anas has done in the past and what he's done now. I believe that in those instances, he observed wrongdoing that was ongoing.
But he
did not instigate. You see, that's the difference.
Sir, the issues you're raising now would apply. For example, issues about the identity and capacity of Tiger IPI would exist also with what he did with customs. It will come up with also what he did with electricity and so on. So basically, we are speaking about...
I understand that issue that you've raised. You see, Superior Court judges are unfortunately put in a certain category within the constitutional dispensation. Would or should lawyers representing those people affected... Maybe we should have asked some hard questions earlier on. And I think that, admittedly, maybe it's hit home now because it involves persons that I represent. Maybe we should have asked some questions earlier on. Maybe we were taken in by the euphoria, the hype and everything that had gone on, and we didn't ask some hard questions. Maybe it's about time we put some legislation in place dealing with the issues of private investigators. It is only when some things arise that there are calls for reform, there are calls, because indeed you could potentially be having a problem where someone motivated by whatever it is could hide the services of a private investigator and cause mayhem. Pure mayhem in the name of the right to disclose.
And you could also have a situation where the private investigator gets away until he touches a judge.
That is an interesting one. You know, I think that I personally would not even have entered this matter if there was evidence that a judge on a continuous basis had been doing a wrongful act and had been captured on tape. And so maybe the relative
of that person. Without enticement.
Without enticement. You see, that is the problem. Then you are clear in your mind that This is conduct that is voluntary. That for me is the issue. And especially where there was even evidence in one of the cases I am representing that the person actually drove the instigators away. So you begin to, you know, there are some questions that begin to come up. What is the motivation? You know, what is the motivation?
Well, sir, thank you very much for coming.
I am exceedingly grateful and
giving us this education and to a very large extent enlightenment on the law and processes. And so we are most grateful to you.
It's quite a privilege coming on hot issues, very, you know, highly ranked and very, very, you know, educative program. I think that we hope that at least some of the issues would have been clarified. And we hope that the courts would, however it is, the axe will fall. And however it falls, we'll have to live with the consequences. But at least it is important for the rule of law to be tested.
And sir, most grateful for your compliments. We value them on hot issues.
Very grateful.
Well, viewers, you heard the compliments. And you heard everything. We do hope that we've managed to bring some clarity to the issues. This is not just about hot issues. It's about TV3, the best in the country. And the best in entertainment, best in sports, best in news, and best in everything.